Hello, Naser.
Max, can you hear me?
I can hear you. Yes, it seems there's a small glitch or something didn't quite right, so we have to set you up sort of with the participants already. I had to start the. Usually it's in practice mode beforehand. Somehow that didn't work. So okay. Can you share your screen?
Okay, I will try. You need to enable me to share the screen.
Yeah, just 1 second.
Yeah, go ahead.
Now, okay.
Still disabled?
Yeah, your host now, you should be able to do whatever.
Okay, now I can. Now I can, perfect. So let me see. How is the audio, by the way?
It's fine. It's absolutely
okay. Perfect. Can you see my screen?
Yeah. Go into full screen mode. Yeah, perfect.
So everything works fine here. Audio is okay. And the connection. I mean, I sometimes face some issues, but now today I'm sitting in a good spot where I have a good, I mean, in my house, just to get a good internet connection.
Okay.
So by the way, are the people will see me? I mean, I didn't see that, let me see, that video. Oh, okay, now.
Yes, actually, I made you the sole host. Can you make me back co-host? Because I was
sure, a bit. Sure, let me see how to do that now.
We have to go to the participant list with all the panelists. I can reclaim host. Okay, it's fine. And then it's okay.
Okay, now, so I don't need to do anything. I see.
You don't need to do anything.
Okay.
I think we're fine now. Yeah, that was just because okay. It was getting a bit hectic. I clicked the wrong button. So, okay, I will give a quick intro. I mean, you've seen the previous webinars, I suppose. Then we'll get going. And given that we are at 9 o'clock already, I think we'll just get into it right away.
Perfect.
And let's see. Yeah, okay, so good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody, and apologies for sort of having to witness the whole sort of behind the scenes thing, but yeah, there was a slight glitch in how we were setting it up, but I think it's all running now. So, well, as you're all aware, today it will be Naser Meqbel on ModEM, a user's guide, and I think this is going to be very interesting, well, for all of us, because I think there's no question that ModEM is the most used and most important 3D MT inversion code that's out there in the moment, and Naser has been sort of central to its development. Before we get to introduce Naser, I just want to make you aware of the upcoming seminar, and those of you who have attended a few of these will notice that Alan has squeezed now all the upcoming ones into one slide. So you can see we have a great range of speakers. The next one is also on inversion by Malcolm Sambridge. And then we have Andreas Junger on anisotropy. Jim McNay on airborne systems, Juan Carlos Afonso on multi-data and multi-scale probabilistic inversions, Alessandro Santalino on swarm intelligence in magnetophilic inversion. Phil Wanamaker is going to talk about petrological systematics of electrical conductivity. And then in a similar way, vein, Kate Selvey and Sinan Zaidin on laboratory results encoded and made. And then in July, and I think those are the last one for this term, we'll then go into the summer break. We have Yasuo Ogawa on imaging fluids in the crust and Lucy McGregor on multiphysics analysis and extracting the most from diverse data sets. So yeah, a lot to keep us busy for the next few weeks. I suppose by now most of you are veterans and you've seen this page on MTNet where you can also see previous presentations. So if you've missed anything, there's the video link and a link to the presentation where if the speaker provided those, so you can recap what has happened. And hopefully by now most of you also are aware of the functionality in Zoom that's specific to the webinar. And the way we're going to do this here is that if you have any question, please use the Q&A box. There's also the chat function, but that we typically don't use very much. But there's a Q&A button that you can use to ask questions. I will monitor that. But so far, we've always dealt with them at the end. If there's a real emergency or you really want to say something, you can raise your hand. Actually, two people did that. Does that actually mean something? I know that sort of stopped raising their hand. So I think I'll skip over that. But yeah, if there's some real issue, you can do that or you really want to speak. And yeah, that's the functionality of Zoom for the EMinar. And then now I'd like to introduce you a little bit about Naser. I mean, I know Naser for a while already, but for example, I didn't know that you did your master's in Cologne. So so you did his master's in Cologne and then moved to the Free University in Berlin and also worked at GFZ. And I think that's when we started sort of to get acquainted with each other. And yeah, he's been working extensively on 2D and 3D electrical and electromagnetic modeling. And yeah, together with Gary Eckbert, and I think Anna Kelberg was also quite involved in that, they developed ModEM. Now he is involved in a research project at the National Observatory of Brazil in Rio to develop 3 inversion for multi-marine EM data, and that's funded by Shell Brazil. And as probably most of you know, in addition to his scientific work, Naser also is a consultant for 3D EM methods for geothermal and mineral exploration companies worldwide. And with that, I will hand the screen over to you, Naser, and I'm looking forward to hearing your talk.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Max, for this introduction. And good morning, good evening, everybody. I hope that you can see my screen in a full mode. Okay?
Yes, all fine.
Okay, perfect. So again, thank you very much for this introduction and also this opportunity to give this talk on the EMinar. Because as you mentioned, I mean, ModEM is right now is the most used code for 3D inversion of MT data in academic world. And it's a great opportunity to highlight some points on how to use the code from a user perspective as well as from a developer perspective. But mostly this talk will be on from a user perspective and to highlight some points on how to use it in a best way. I here put the logo from all or most of the institutes, company who contributed previously and recently to ModEM. And I just want to mention here, for example, that the code was developed originally at Oregon State University in the United States. And previously when I was working at the GFZ here in Germany, we contributed a little bit during my PhD to parallelize the code and more tested the code. And most recently we are working, or I work at the Observatory National in Rio de Janeiro to further develop the code in collaboration with Shell Brazil. So the outlines will be, as I said, mostly on how to use the code in the best way. So, but before that, I will give a brief introduction on the code itself and what is the idea behind it, namely modularity of electromagnetic methods. And then I will go slowly on how to compile the code, how to set it up, and how to run it on your own cluster or server, with gradually increasing the level of users and show advanced setting. And most importantly, in my opinion, which is most of the people will be interested with, for example, how to perform resolution tests using the code and using some examples, I would show that. And finally, giving some hints on how to control your inversion results, and not only looking at one single number, which what we call it the RMS or the root mean square value, but also diving inside the results and your data in order to give more insight from your data. So, to introduce ModEM, it is really very important to stop a little bit at the name. I mean, most of people, it is not only pronunciation name, but also the name has some meaning. So most of people, they call it ModEM. I mean, it is not the ModEM that you have in your living room, but it is pronounced as ModEM. And the name stands for the Modular System for Electromagnetic Data. And this is the philosophy behind that code. I mean, the modularity is the central word in this naming of the code. So what is the modularity means? I mean, all of us know that you can write pieces of the code and later you want to connect them in order to get a functional code. The idea behind the modularity is once you connect them, then you will get a functional code. But beside that is if you want to change anything inside any of these modules, the whole system should work. Okay, so this is something really very important. And we pay a lot of attention on this point in order to make the code functional for multiple EM methods. Right now it is in a frequency domain, but this is the central point. I will give some ideas and some examples on how that works and the central meaning of the modularity. So this is the structure of ModEM code. Don't be scared. I will not go over all of these points and boxes, but this is to display the idea behind the code and the connection between various components inside the code. But the whole system can be summarized in only three levels. You have at the top an inversion and some message passing interface to parallelize the whole system. And in the middle level, you have the interface. And in the lower level, which is the engine, I will call it, is the forward modeling solver, let us call it. So these three levels are connected somehow to each other to have a functional code. Now, where is the modularity in that context? So let us take the lower level where we have the forward modeling, where you solve some partial differential equation for the electric or magnetic field. And this is the core of the EM methods in frequency domain. So for example, if you want to have several forward modeling inside the whole system and plugged into the system, everything should work. For example, the inversion should work for MPC, SEM, DC by simply plugging a solver to consider the solution, the electromagnetic solution from CSEM, or the forward modeling from DC geoelectric. In other words, you change in one module, which is the forward modeling, plug these additional solvers, the inversion and the parallelization should work. Of course, you need to adjust a few things in the interface in order to make the whole system work. But this is one of the central ideas behind the modular system. Of course, you can increase. For example, right now for the solver itself, where you solve the partial differential equation, you can change as much as you want, for example, changing the solver. Right now we have QMR, quasi minimum residual, you can plug another solver. So nothing should be changed for the inversion or the interface or the solution itself. So this is a very important point, and I wanted really to emphasize that point in a little bit more detail. So right now, the code, you can imagine it as, let me activate pointer here, as a core where you have all components required to get the electromagnetic solution. Now, as you know, if you have a passive natural source, all of these methods can be derived from the basic output element from the forward modeling solution. For example, we solve now for the electric field. So once you have the electric field and get the magnetic field out of it, you can derive any of these quantities based on the same code. And right now we have all of these methods included for the natural source. And for active source, we have, for example, the control source of CSEM and CSEMG. And most recently, we are working in extending the code to semi-airborne EM. So this is basically the idea behind the modularity, okay? And further development, including, for example, what we are working on at the moment, the National Observatory in Rio de Janeiro, for example, in our academic project, is to extend the model, for example, not only for these methods, but all, but inside the code itself and the solver itself, for example, considering multi-resolution grid. And there are some publication on the modified system of equation or how to consider the partial differential equation. And the symbol anisotropy, for example, and joint inversion, which is the central part of our project in Rio de Janeiro. Some other contributions, because in a second, I will show you what you will get when you apply for academic version of the code. You will get the source code. So many other colleagues who got the code and start to extend it further. For example, colleagues from China in collaboration with Martin Answorth in Alberta University, they developed, for most recently, it is a publication submitted, general anisotropy based on ModEM. And another group from Frankfurt University, Andreas Jung and colleagues, they also developed the apparent resistivity tensor inversion and much more. This is what I could trace based on the communication that I have with other colleagues. So for the academic version that you will get, you will have all of these methods highlighted inside this shape here. And I believe that the most used methods or to run the inversion are mostly with the full impedance tensor and Tibber data. And to less extent, people use, for example, the interstation magnetics transfer function or phase tensor or aberrant resistivity and phases. So these methods are less, that's at least in my experience and in connection with other users. So, but all of these methods are available for you when you get the academic version of ModEM. Now, how to set up the code? Once you get an account and register for the academic version of the code, we will send you the source code. Now, one step or the first step that most of people struggle with is how to get that source code compiled and run on a specific server or the cluster. I will not go on the details on a specific server or cluster because it depends on what is the architect and other specification of your cluster. But generally speaking, the source code, the folder that you will get has few make files that will give you the idea on how to compile the code. For example, a makefile for the GFORTRAN compiler, BGI, or Intel compiler. So based on your the compiler installed on your server or cluster, you can simply run the make or specified makefile with -f, then you will get the executable. Okay, that is something very straightforward. Of course, you need some adjustment to fit your, as I said, to fit the architect of your server and or compiler. Very important is to make sure if you want to run the code in parallel, you need to make sure that the MPI, the message passing interface library, is installed on your machine. This is the only requirement as a third party library. Aside from this, everything is self-contained if you only want to run it in a serial, so you don't need this this library here. Now, based also on some communication I have with few users, actually, is it is not obvious how to switch between the parallel or MPI version and the serial version. So most of them, they modify the code based on their compiler, and they forgot to add some flags to the compiler to tell the compiler to run it or to compile it in MPI. So what we use is a simple keyword and pass to the preprocessor. Each compiler has preprocessor, for example, this one for GFortran, and the keyword is minus the MPI. If you have this keyword passed to the preprocessor, then it will compile for MPI version or parallel computing. If you remove that keyword, then of course it will compile for serial version. That is the keyword. I mean, this is very simple. And keep in mind and pay attention when you modify any of these makefile to consider this keyword. And keep in mind, without it, it will compile for serial version. With that keyword, it will compile for the parallel version. Also, we don't only provide the source file in the academic version, but also it includes user manual. And the user manual, I mean, most of the talk that I will show today is mostly explained in the user manual, but I will go over some details from my experience to show you how to run the code and use it in a good way. Beside that, we have sort of copyright agreement in which we specify for you as a user what are the rules and as a developer what are the rules. So please take a look at this copyright. It's 1.5 pages. It's not a Microsoft or a Google agreement where you need to scroll down 10 minutes, but it is really a simple one. We highlighted it, what are the rules. Okay, so once you compile the code, you will get an executable. Let us call it ModEM. By the way, you can change the name in the makefile to call it whatever you want. But basically, you will get an executable called ModEM, and you need to pass some argument to run the code. In a serial way, that is the simple run. So you specify the executable that you got after compiling, and you pass some command line. And this is the central topic of my talk today. What are the command line? What is the command line and how we can adjust few things in order to get relatively good results. But for a parallel run, of course, you need to run, as I said before, you need to install or make sure that the MPI library is installed. And this library includes also some executable to distribute your job across several CPUs or nodes. So the simple run for MPI or parallel is MPI run minus n number of CPU you want to assign for this job. And of course, again, your executable, which is ModEM here in this context, and the argument related to ModEM. Why I put that here? Because also based on some communication with some users, it is not clear how to define the number of CPUs assigned for this job. So recalling or giving the information that ModEM is parallelized over period and the two polarization in 3D, that means for your data, you need to know how many periods you have in your data set and multiply it by two for the tubularization and plus one CPU as a master. So this is the maximum number you need for your run. Anything beyond this number, this maximum number, it will just preserve the CPU sitting around doing nothing. The minimum CPU you need are two, because you one of them will be the master, one of them will be the worker. Anything between these two numbers will work perfectly. So it is not required to have the maximum number, and it is not required, but you have to have this minimum number of CPU. Of course, with the maximum number of CPU, you will get the high performance of ModEM. And I forget to mention that also in during our project in Shell, we are trying to get to another level of parallelization. That means not only parallelizing over number of period or frequency in your data, but also to massive parallelization. And that includes, for example, domain decomposition and so on to make it faster. We hope that. Okay. But this is very important for you as a user to know how to define number of CPU assigned for your job. Look at your data, how many periods, multiply it by two, add one for the master, and that will should do the work. Okay, now the command line. This is the most important thing that most of you are attending today to know exactly what kind of commands command line pass to ModEM. Of course, I mean, they are flags passed to ModEM to perform specific tasks. For example, with minus F stands for forward modeling, you will run forward modeling on a specific model to know the response of that model. Of course, for a given set of sites and positions. And keep in mind, I mean, you don't have to have data and errors in the data file in order to get the responses. You could have zeros. I mean, this is also something that should be mentioned. The most important thing for the forward modeling is to have a model with some structures that you need to know the response of them. And of course, some sites where you need to know the response and the period, the layout or range for these responses. The other, and I believe the most used comment or flag is minus I, which stands for the inversion, is to run an inversion for a given data set. And I believe that most of you are already familiar with that, but I will emphasize also during this talk very important things and additional information. To less extent, this flag, minus C, stands for the covariances, is a flag to apply smoothing, either the inversion or the forward modeling. I will explain that during the talk on a given model. So simply, if you want to run smoothing or to smooth a specific model, you need to run the code with minus C. And where it is applied, why it is applied, you will see it during the code. To less extent, I mean, the computation of the Jacobian matrix is also provided. And I mean, there are many other flags, but I'm listing here the most important one, at least in my opinion. And with minus G, you will get the sensitivity matrix. Some people are interested to know the sensitivity of the data toward change in specific models. So they run minus G for, let us say, model resolution test. Although I personally don't recommend that, and I will show you an alternative way on how to perform model resolution test without having to compute the sensitivity matrix. And keep in mind, I mean, sensitivity matrix is very big, and if you save it to visualize it, it might be a tedious work. Anyway, so let us start with the first flag, which is to run the forward modeling. As I said, with minus F, you will tell ModEM to perform the forward modeling and to give you the responses for a specific model on a specific set of sites and variables. What is best to ModEM is, of course, you need a 3D model, an input model, and it contains the electrical conductivity for the grid that you have, and you need the positions of the sites, and as well as the period layout, and what you will get are the model responses. Here is just an example of the apparent resistivity and phases for some specific data points. And as I said, if your data file has zeros for the data and the error, it doesn't matter because we only need to know the location of the site and the period at which you want to know the responses. This is the basic input model and data and the output. But of course, there are additional output optional also. You don't need to provide them, but they might be helpful for you for some particular reason. So again, if you specify the input model data and you will get the response optionally, you can get the electric field solution that we computed on this grid and to get the responses, but you can get it as values where you can visualize it. For example, you can visualize the electric field solution to better understanding how the electric field behave for at the top of your model. But not only this, I mean, this electric field solution, not only for visualization, but also it has specific use later if you want to run the nested model, okay? In addition to that, as an optional also, you can specify the parameters required for the solver itself. So how many iterations, to which level of tolerance you want to the solver get the solution, and so on. So all of these parameters are inside the forward modeling configuration or parameter file. So it is simply to control the solver. Okay, before we start or continue on the other flags and some comments for ModEM, allow me to say a few words on the model and data file formats, because it's very important, and to just to clarify a few points on that. So the input model file, it is an ASCII file, and it contains some flag or some comment line, and another line to specify how many cells you have in X, Y, and Z direction. And why I want to say here is also there is a flag to specify if it is a natural logarithmic or a linear values, because many people confused by this file when they look at the numbers. If you look here where my pointer is, I mean, people assign, for example, 100 ohm meters for their model. And when they look at the values, they see something like this, or the natural logarithmic of 100 ohm meter. So they don't see 100 because it is a natural logarithmic of the 100. Of course, you can specify, when you write such a file, you can specify linear values. In that case, you will see 100 and so on. It doesn't matter what you specify here, logarithmic or a linear value, because at the end of the day, is inside ModEM, we convert everything to logarithmic because we work in a logarithmic space. So it is just for you, for your visualization or for your interest when looking at this file to know exactly what you specify here and what you are seeing here. Of course, this line will define the cell dimension in X direction, in Y direction, and in Z direction. So these are the basic header information in the model file. And here, as I said, you can start to see in that example are the logarithmic, the natural logarithmic of the resistivity value. And we save the values in slice wise. For example, this is the first layer. If you scroll down, you will see the second layer and so on. And the value are arranged in X and Y direction. So this is the basic, or this is the format of the model file that you want to specify. Now, the data file is, again, an ASCII file, and it contains, again, a header where we specify what we are expecting to read next, okay? This example here for the full impedance data block, where it is saved in a list format. And I will explain it in a second, in a few words, okay? So, but again, we have some command line where you specify some comments, for example, what you are having in this file or whatever comments you want to write. And then we specify, for example, what kind of data type, the sign convention used, and the units for the values we are going to read. And here the zero outline number six is the rotation of the data, and also you can specify the latitude, longitude for the reference point. This latitude, longitude of the reference point is not used inside the code itself. It is just for your visualization tools in order to put these sites in a geographic coordinate system. Okay, so it is not used. We use the Cartesian coordinate X, Y, Z, and we compute everything based on this Cartesian coordinate. Here, this line number eight, we specify number of periods and site. This is the first well-known user problem, is how to define the number of periods. And keep in mind that ModEM, you don't need to have the same period layout and number for all sites, which means that you can have a different number for each site and even for each period. For example, imagine that you want to mask specific point at specific site. You can go ahead and do that. That will result that some component will have less or more periods than the others. It doesn't matter for ModEM. It works with all kind of combination. But here you need to pay attention that the integer here at line number eight stands for the number of period should represent the maximum number of the period at any given site in your data. That's because we initialize some vectors when reading this data file with a maximum number. So if you specify less, for example, then it will crash, of course, and will not run anymore. The second integer on line number eight is number of sites. Okay, and also you need to give exactly how many sites do you have in your data set. Here we start, on these lines here, we start to specify, for example, before going to the second block, we start to specify, for example, the period and the site ID. Here are the latitude, longitude of the sites. Again, they are not used inside the code. You can have zeros here. It doesn't matter. But it is only for visualization purposes. You need to, or it's better to have the geographic coordinate of your sites. What is important are the X, Y, Z coordinate, and these are on these three lines. And then we specify the component of the impedance tensor we need to invert later. And here we start to specify the data by giving the real and imaginary parts and uncertainty or the error associated with these data points. As you can see here, one of the point is that you can remove any of these lines. Okay, so for example, this is for the same period and this is the full impedance at this site. But imagine that you decided, okay, this point here, this data point doesn't look okay for me. If you visualize it or based on the numbers here, you decided to remove that line. You can simply remove that line from this file. Everything should work. Not to forget to give the maximum number here of periods. Okay. The nice thing is, as I said before, this modularity principle in ModEM, that means that you can add any other block inside the same data file and to run the inversion. As a simple example, if your data set has the vertical magnetic transfer function, you can simply add these data in the same file by adding another block. The block in the file. For example, if you scroll down in that file, I have another block defined for the vertical magnetic transfer function or tipper data. And again, you need to specify the sign convention and the geographic coordinate, and also number of periods and stations. Again, here this block can be less period, but inside the block you need to give the maximum number for any sites for the vertical magnetic transfer function. For example, here you could have 10, that's the maximum. Imagine that you don't want to include long period from tipper or short period or whatever period. You can exclude them from tipper and you need to adjust this number to reflect what you have exactly in the data file. The other highlight of that data format, I mean, is that you can put, for example, if you decided, although it is not available for in the academic version at the moment, is the CSEM or DC Geoelectric to jointly invert them. You can include everything in the same data file by specifying another block and so on. Let me stop for a second here on the Z coordinate, because okay, the XY coordinate are obvious, and you can compute them reference to any point. If you start with EDI files where you have latitude, longitude, you can use any reference point to get the XY coordinate of the sites. And for the Z coordinate, it is really very important to know something that we work in these coordinate systems. So we have negative Z upwards and positive downwards. And I use usually this example here to highlight what does that mean. For example, this data set has sites at the top of topography and some marine empty sites. So that means for the sites that are located at the seafloor, they have a positive Z sign. So they are below the zero, and since we go in a plus sign downwards, so all of these sites located at the sea bottom, they have a plus sign. Whereas the sites located at the top of the mountains, they are above the zero level, they have a minus sign. So this is very important because I've got the impression that some people, they mix between that and they end up, for example, having the sites either at the bottom or inside the model or somewhere in the model and not exactly at where they should be, okay? Another important point here also with regard this the Z coordinate. So again, these are the Cartesian. These are not the elevation of the site. It is where this site should be located at the Earth surface. So they deviate from the actual or the absolute elevation what you measure in the field, because at the end you want to put this site inside a grid and it should locate at the top of the Earth. And that depends strongly on how you discretize the model or the grid in the vertical direction. Okay, so this is very important to know. And many people mixed between the elevation that they have in the EDI files, for example, and the location in this file. So many complaints came to me and saying, yeah, I have the elevation. That on this part in the data file, the elevation is different. Of course, because at the end, you need to put the site exactly at the top of the Earth surface. And that depends on how you discretize the model in the vertical direction. Pay attention to that point, especially if you are working with topography. Okay, so this is a very important point that I should also emphasize at that point. Now back to our flag minus F. And again, these the command line, these are the input, and this is the basic output, and these are the optional output. Now, a few comments on the electric field solution is the binary file in which we store all the electric field component EX, EY, EZ at all cell edges for all periods for both polarization. So don't wonder if you output that file and you found it a large one, although it is binary file, okay? So the next slide, I will explain why it is that large and visualizing these kind of this component. It's also necessary, as I said before, if you want to perform nested modeling and use that electric field. I mean, this parameter or the control file is an ASCII file, and it has some parameters to control the solvers. And if you want to run later the nested modeling, you can use or specify the output electric field solution. Here are the few words on or to explain why the electric field solution is too large. Let us take any cube from your 3D model. And what we do when solving this partial differential equation for the electric field, what we are computing are the electric field component at all of these edges for a given period that is presented in omega for this conductivity distribution in your model. And this is for specific period and specific source of polarization. And in 3D, we solve for two polarization. So now imagine that electric field solution file will contain all of these components for each period at all of these cubes or edges and for the two polarization. So don't wonder if the file is too large, okay? But these are the information that will be stored inside the file. Okay, now the second important or most used and interesting flag is the minus I. And I again stands for the inversion. And if you have a data set, and that's what most of the user are interested with, is to invert their data for a conductivity model. And this is the flag that you need to use for the inversion. Now, the inversion or ModEM with minus I will initiate or perform the inversion. Of course, you need to specify what kind of inversion algorithm you want to use. Again, back to this modularity idea. Right now, or the most tested inversion algorithm is the nonlinear conjugate gradient. But we do have, for example, the data space conjugate gradient and other developed methods or inversion algorithm. So you can, if as a developer, you can come up with some idea to say, okay, I need to apply this kind of inversion algorithm. All components required to do that search algorithm are provided. You only need to put the math inside a module and plug it to the system, and it should work. But for you as a user, you need to specify. And as I said again, I mean, the most used and stable algorithm is the NLCG or nonlinear conjugate gradient. So again, if you want to run the inversion, the basic input. Actually, there is no output to specify here, but the basic input is you have a data, and this is your basic or initial input, and you created some model, and you want to project this the data from the data space to the model space via the inversion. You only need to specify the input model file and input data file. Nothing else should be provided more than this, and the inversion will run using some default values for other parameters, which I will explain, and that you can control via some files. But this is the basic input for the inversion. The first level of or advanced level for the input that another optional inversion parameter file in which you can control the inversion run. For example, how many iterations you want to allow an LCG to run, and what are the stopping criteria, and so on. You can specify all of these inside the inversion parameter file. And the second level of parameters provided for the inversion, as well as optional, are to control the solver, the forward modeling solver. Again, this is the same file used before for the forward modeling, where you can control the solver and specify some numbers on how to perform the solver itself. The most interesting, and where I want to invest time during this talk, are these two, or the third and fourth level of parameters, namely how to specify the model covariance, what is the meaning of that, and also the last level where you specify starting model. And keep in mind, I mean, this is also a confusing point that many people get confused to distinguish between starting model and the prior model. And I will emphasize that in more details during the talk. Before I start talking about the model covariance and these two comment lines in the third and fourth level, just to say a few words on what we are doing during the inversion process. And I guess all of you are familiar and early days saw such kind of objective function where you have the data misfit term and the constraint term, and the whole process aim at minimizing this function to get some models. Okay, that fits, of course, your data subject to some constraint. What I want to say here is that, and related to the command line covariance or the model
smoothing, is where we are applying that. So our constraint is to get a smooth model, and how we are performing the smoothing on the provided model is using this equation. So you will get some, after minimization, you will get some delta n. And this model perturbation are smooth and added to the what we call prior model to get a model that you plug to the forward modeling to get the responses. I mean, in the references related to ModEM, you will see N0. Although it is a little bit confusing here, and I personally prefer to replace it with the prior model. So just to distinguish between the model obtained from zero iteration
from the prior model, which is also a central point during the inversion process. So keep in mind, M0, if you see it in some references, it is referred to the prior model. Okay. So we apply smoothing on the obtained model perturbation added to the prior model to get the model that we want to use in the forward modeling and output it for you for the visualization. So this model is the minimized or obtained at the kth iteration to minimize the objective function. Now, I just made that previous slide on the mathematical formulation to emphasize where we are using the smoothing. And now the question is, do we really need to use the model covariance file? As it is an optional, as you see here, it's an optional input file. And the question is, are we going to use it or should we use it or not? To answer this question is, if you are working with a simple model, you don't have topography, you don't have bathymetry, and you don't want to change the smoothing parameter, you are fine with the default value, which are 0.3 for your information, then you don't need to use that model covariance file. So you can simply leave it and don't bother yourself with that. However, if you are working with a model that contains topography and or bathymetry, you need to use it. Otherwise, the inversion will start changing the parameters, the model parameters inside the air or inside the water. You don't need to let the inversion change anything
inside these model parameters because they are fixed. You know what is the conductivity of the water, and you usually fix it during any inversion process. You're only interested in the model parameters related to the subsurface or to the earth. So in that case, you need to use the model covariance file, because the model covariance file is not only where you specify the smoothing parameter, but also where you define where the inversion should fix the values and where they are free. And this is explained and outlined in the model covariance file. So if you create or have the model covariance file, there are 16 lines where we explain the format. So I will not go over these lines, but I will emphasize one specific point, namely that inside this file, we are working with indices. So each model parameter has two attributes, one conductivity and one index. During the inversion, we check if this index is assigned to change the model parameter or it is fixed. And based on that, we update the model. Beside that, I mean, there are here, for example, you specify again, it is an ASCII file. And as I said, it's really explained here. But quickly going over these numbers here, you specify how many cells you have in X, Y, and Z direction. And here on these three lines, you specify the smoothing. And for the smoothing, by the way, values, they could be...
They change off. They could be from 0 to 0.9. I mean, I never used this minimum and maximum. I usually start, if you are asking me personally, I usually start with like 0.2 or 0.3. Run the inversion, try to change or increasing the smoothing parameter to
0.4 or 0.5 and another experiment with 0.1, 0.2 and try to understand and analyze which model reflect better, fit the data first and reflect better the geological interpretation. So it is like a trial and error experiment by changing only two or three values. I mean, going up one value, going down one value. What I want to say from this slide here again is that we are working with indices, and when ModEM reads that file, it sees there is zeros, for example. Zero and nine indices are reserved for air and water. That means when ModEM reads that file and find that this model parameter has zero value, that means it is related to air and it will not change it. If it is nine, then it is related to water and it will not change it, or bathymetry, or in marine environment. So this is the idea behind that model covariance file. So again, it is not only to apply the smoothing, which are defined here on this line, but also to tell what model parameter I need to change, what model parameter I don't want to change. Again, for the reminder, I mean, if you take any block from the model, it has two attributes. First attribute is the electrical conductivity, and this is something that you stored in the model input file, and the indices, which are stored in the model covariance file. Again, during the inversion, we check these two. If it is zero, then nothing will be changed on the electrical conductivity. If it is nine, also nothing will be changed. Anything between these two numbers, it's free. I mean, the inversion will simply alter the electrical conductivity and adjust the value in order to fit the data during the inversion process. So this is basically what you want to consider when looking at this file. Another parameter, which is in my opinion, maybe it is not well used and tested, or it is tested by us or by some users, but for you as a user, maybe you didn't use that option here. Namely, It is like, if you are familiar with the 2D, is the tear zones where you specify some region in your 3D model and you want to switch off the smoothing between these two regions. And here the indices idea plays a huge role because you can define areas. Let me show you an example here. You can define areas in your 3D model and give them some index. Okay, so for example, by default, you can give all your model parameter related to the Earth, which is this green cells here, they give them an index of one. Of course, if you have an ocean, which is here, the conductive, red conductive body here, automatically you need to give it an index of 9 in the model covariance line. However, let us consider now the Earth or the cells or model parameter related to the subsurface and Earth. So imagine that you want to test something inside this region for some specific reason. Okay. So what you can do is to define an index of 2 for all these cells inside this block in the 3 dimension. I mean, in X, Y, and Z direction. This is a map view at specific slide. But the idea is now is to switch off the smoothing between this region and the other region. You can imagine, you can extend that and make it like a 2D and representing some fault or representing some discontinuity in your model.
And you want to switch off the smoothing between these two regions. In the model
covariance file, you can specify this kind of operation. Namely, at this line here. Now, zero stands, it is actually in our convention, it's called exceptions. Exceptions mean I want to apply some exceptions in terms of smoothing. And if you have, instead of zero, you have one, that means you only want to have one exception. And this exception in the smoothing operation is to switch off the smoothing between region with index of 1 and 2. So here is, that means the smoothing is 0. That means I'm switching off the smoothing. You can specify here the smoothing value instead of using the default or what you already have for all the model parameter. You can specify how much smoothing you want to have between these two regions by changing this 0 from 0 to 0.1 or 0.2 or whatever. But if you have it 0, that means the smoothing will be switched off between all of these, between region number 2 and the rest of the model. Again, this is maybe an option in order to test few ideas inside your model during the inversion process. So this is something that I really wanted to emphasize, and as I said, it is maybe not well known that there are something that you need to specify here in order to come up or to perform this tear zone idea. Okay, so the last level inside the model run is, in addition
to the model covariance, you can specify a model perturbation file or the starting model file. And it has really an advantage. And I will explain it here during the next few slides. To use this option, it is very important to know what we are outputting at each iteration during the inversion process. So at each iteration, you will get a set of files. And for example, here the number underscore, this number is the related to NLCG iteration. So what you will get is the inverted model, and that is what you usually use to visualize and look at the model. And also you will get the predicted data related to that model. And also there is a file called TRM, or the transport model parameter. They are the rough lab symbols. And this output here, it has a purpose and for a few reasons. Okay. The simplest the simplest reason is, imagine that during your inversion process, for some technical reason, the inversion stopped. For example, some technical related to the cluster, of course, or something happened with the electricity and the inversion stopped. So what you need to do, the inversion run to 60 iteration and the stopping criteria didn't reach. So what should I do? Should I restart the inversion from zero and start the whole operation again? And imagine that each iteration, you have a huge model, a lot of data points set. And are you going to run that for another 20 hours or 40 hours? No, you don't need to do that. You can use that PRM file to re-invert or restart the inversion by giving that starting model. And in that case, this command line will have two model parameter files. The first one is the input or the prior model, exactly at this in this line. That will be the prior model and that will be the starting model. Okay. Don't confuse yourself between when I say the model perturbation or the starting model and model. The model that you or the file that you provide here is called the starting model, but it contains the model perturbation in a rough way. Okay, so they are not the smooth. So if you provide that file here, the DRM file, at the end of the command line, the inversion will start from the last model that you got before the inversion process stopped. Okay, some people, to some extent, I agree with that, is they don't use that PRM file. They keep using, but instead of
that prior model, which was at the beginning a homogeneous, let us imagine that you start your inversion with a homogeneous half space, and if you include topography or bathymetry, that was your prior model. So after it stopped, okay, and you change and use that inverted model instead of that model, of course you can keep doing this, but your reference model for the entire process will be changed from a homogeneous half space to a model here, or the prior model will be obtained from this file. But it could be not that is your prior model that you want really to force the inversion not to deviate that much from that model. In one word, I personally recommend if the inversion stops, use the PRM file in that way in order to rerun the inversion. Okay. And don't forget, if that situation happens, don't forget that the new run now after restarting, it will change. I mean, the counter will start from zero. Okay. But the model themselves, they will be the model parameter obtained from iteration number 60. So don't forget to change the output file name if you want to keep the previous run. So here you can specify, for example, the names for these files. And usually, for example, I specify run number one, run number two, in order not to override the previous run. So this is very important. Two steps here, or two points that you need to keep in mind, is if you want to restart the inversion, use the PRM file and not the raw file and put it here, because in that case, you will change the reference point. That is my interpretation and my personal experience when running an inversion. Okay. But this is not the only use. Again, this is the example here. The inversion stopped after 60 iterations. So I simply use the same command line that I have used before, okay, when I started the inversion. But now I provided this PRM file from iteration number 60, and the inversion will continue. Okay. And I will not lose anything from the previous one. And again, in that context, that will be the prior model and that will be the starting model. Okay. But this is not the only use for this PRM file. It has another use, and namely, and this is what is most of us are interested with, is to perform the model resolution study. And to explain that, I am going to use a real world example from a public data set. I recently experimented with this data set and to highlight a few points. But these data set are already published by colleagues from the United States, and it is from the Newberry geothermal area. So again, I use that data set really not to for this presentation for the model resolution study, but to experiment with some ideas to invert the phase tensor and the impedance and so on. So it is more or less some experimental process that I have used with this data. Quickly on this data, they are broadband from around 100 hertz to less than 1,000 seconds. And they contain the full impedance tensor. Minimum site spacing is around 500. And in order to run this experiment that I was talking about, I discretized the model with this kind of discretization with a minimum sites, cell size, more or less equivalent to the site spacing. So it is not fine model. It is considered to be a coarse model. Again, it is just to test a few ideas. But what I paid attention here, because I have included topography, again, a careful gridding in the Z direction is required, again, when you work with topography. And for the inversion, I have started with 500 ohm meters. The error setting, I use my own, I mean, this gradual decreasing approach in order to get a good fit and explain the data in a good way. The total number of NLCG iteration in total, it was around 130 NLCG iteration. So why I'm showing this is like, if you got such a model and you submit a paper or you want to present that, and but you need to give some confidence on your and some of these features that you get from your model. And I'm using this this example here. I didn't perform the model resolution study on this model yet, but I'm using it just to emphasize a few points from technical point of view. For example, if some question mark like here on this conductive anomaly, or let us take the most prominent feature here below the Newberry caldera, which in some region it is around 10 ohm meter inside this blob here. And you want to perform a model resolution study and to tell the readers or the reviewers or whoever interested in this feature, how the data or do the data require this conductive anomaly or not? And how is your model sensitive to such kind of conductive anomaly? So the answer for that will be, of course, the model resolution study. You can do it in several ways. I mean, some people do it in a computing the sensitivity matrix, trying to analyze the sensitivity matrix in order to get more information how the data are sensitive toward changes inside these kind of conductive material. What I usually do is to alter. So we have the preferred model. Our preferred model contains such kind of conductive anomaly. One of the idea to perform this model resolution study is to alter the conductivity values inside the target area. For example, all model parameters inside the caldera or below the caldera, I've changed them and reset them to the resistivity value I used in the starting model or the prior model, which was 500 ohm meter. So all the cells in X, Y direction and in Z direction. So this is a map view. This is again, cross section along this line here. And as you can see here, using an appropriate tools, you can reset these values and reset them to the background resistivity that you used during the inversion or when you start the inversion. Now run this inversion and see if you if the data will get you back to that conductive anomaly, or it all the inversion will remove that modified model and get more conductive anomaly. Of course, if you use that model here and compute, some people compute only the responses and compare it with the responses from the preferred model, which is also still valid, such kind of process, and see how much the responses change with and without this conductive anomaly. In that case, you can give some confidence on this conductive anomaly. Of course, this is can be done. But if you want to perform an inversion using this kind of modified model, I recommend you to do the following. Okay. So some people use that as now the modified model as a prior model. Again, we are working on the same command line. But in that case, the modified model will be our prior model and the same input file and the other input, the inversion parameter forward modeling and the covariance. Of course, now the inversion will, as we consider that as a prior model, the inversion will stay close to that one. So it will not change that much because you are telling the inversion, this is my prior model and don't go far away from that. And we are penalizing against the deviation from the prior model. Of course, you will keep seeing that if you run the inversion, I didn't run this inversion on this data set. And for other model resolution study, I cannot show the results here. But anyway, if you run the inversion on that specific model, then you will keep seeing the outline of the modified area because the inversion again will not deviate that much from this prior information. Okay. The alternative way is instead of using that modified model as prior model, you can use it as starting model. And here again, the role of that model perturbation file. And how to do that? To do that, you need first to create that PRM file. Okay, and here is the smoothing operator plays the role in this operation. So first you run ModEM with minus C, the covariance, with inversion. So you don't want to get the forward smoothing operator. You want to get the rough model perturbation. In that case, you specify the minus C, the covariance, env, and you provide as an input your modified model parameter, which is this one. As an output, you will get the model perturbation file. These two files are optional, but if you have topography, again, you need to use, or pathometry, you need to use that model covariance file, because once we create this model perturbation file out of this, you need to know where the cells are fixed and where they are free. Moreover, if you want really to get that deviation from a prior model, then you need to specify the prior model. So now the prior model is our homogeneous half space that contains the topography only and homogeneous background model. Let us say, as I've started with this, it was the 500 ohm meter. What will happen now is this operation will apply the inverse of the smoothing and to get the model perturbation file. And that is what you need to use here in order to perform such kind of model resolution study. Now, again, I mean, that should be actually okay. So this is the input, and actually the arrow should point to that model perturbation, because the output from this operation will be the input for this operation here, the main operation. So what is this mathematical, the mathematical meaning of this operation? If you remember, when I quickly introduced the objective function and how and where we are applying the smoothing, you still remember that to get the model, then we apply the smoothing on the model perturbation or the delta M added to the prior model, which is in our example here is a 500 ohm meter to get the model. Now, by rearranging this equation here, and because we want the delta M, and this is the PRM, what we have in the PRM file, the rough or the transport model perturbation. By rearranging this equation, you will get that delta M is what you need is to perform such kind of operation. And this is exactly what is happening if you go back to that command line. So you have the modified system. Here is the command line again. So, the modified model, the modified preferred model, which is located as in the equation as M, and the prior model, which is our input file, and we are interested in that output, the model perturbation. The inverse is to apply the inverse of the smoothing again to get the rough model perturbation. By using this, you are in the safe side that if you run the inversion here, then these are the correct definition of the starting model and the prior model. So this is really a confusion point for many people, including myself sometimes, is to distinguish between the prior and the starting model and so on. It took me a little bit of time to better understanding this and in order to perform such kind of model resolution study. What will happen now, the inversion will not get stuck if and only if the data requires such kind of conductive anomaly in your model, okay? The inversion will not get stuck by this conductive anomaly as if you use it as a prior model. If you use it as a starting model, then the inversion will start modifying heavily in this region in order to get the conductive anomaly. Again, if and only if the data requires such kind of conductive anomaly. So this is the main differences between using the modified model as a prior model or creating a starting model and rerun the inversion. So you will see that there will be a lot of changes here and you will not see anymore these boundaries between this modified region and the rest of the model. Again, keep in mind only and only if the data requires such kind of conductive anomaly. I mean, I have analyzed this kind of data without now, as I said, still didn't do such kind of model resolution study, and it was to experiment something completely different than just looking at the conductive anomaly and where we have conductive and where we don't have. And but when looking at the data, one can see that there are some information about the existence of some conductive anomaly at greater depth. Okay, so with that, I mean the minus C flag passed to ModEM. In my opinion, I mean, of course, if you have some questions later, you can ask me about that more specifically. But this is how you use it and where you need to use it in order to get the starting model. Okay. So some practical remarks. And I've got a question about how to run the root mean square value or the normalized root mean RMS value. So normalized is just to emphasize that it is normalized with respect to the uncertainty or the error inside the data. And this is how we compute it. It's straightforward. So it is the residual, which is the representing the difference between your measured data, your predicted data for a given model, normalized with the error, the sum and square root, or they will be normalized with the number of data points and taking the square root. Very important here is to think about such kind of values. When you look at the log file, I'll show it in a second, is to keep in mind that this is one single number and representing the overall RMS. What does that mean? This number is computed over all your sites, all periods, all components. So it gives you some idea about the performance of the inversion, but this is not the ultimate number that you need to look at in order to judge how good or bad you fit and explain your data. And exactly at this slide here, I will explain the difference between fitting and explaining the data. So you could fit the data to an RMS of one in two iterations by increasing this number, this uncertainty. By signing larger on the data, you will fit the data in two or three inversion iterations. But does that mean that you are minimizing that, or the difference between the measured and predicted data are minimized? No, it doesn't mean that. So you only decreased that value here by increasing the error here. And that doesn't make a lot of sense. Okay, so you are interested in fitting and explaining the data. So I mean, in my experience, I look at the data from a different perspective. So the first, while the inversion is running, of course, all of us look at this overall RMS and see where is the inversion and how it is behaving. So if we look at the log file, by the way, at each iteration or when you start the inversion process, you will get this log file. And inside it, at each iteration, we output some numbers, including the RMS value for that iteration. For example, for this example file here, log file, the starting RMS was 16. After some line search here and the NLCG operation, the RMS is decreased to 30, and so on. So if you see that at iteration number, for example, 4, the RMS is becoming 2.8. So that we're looking at that from the first step, then it is fine to see how the RMS, the overall RMS, is developing from one to another iteration. And if you see some crazy values or something unexpected, then you need to consider again what is wrong in your data and or in your model file. Okay, so this is only to give you a rough idea about how well the data are fitted inside the inversion process. But don't take that as the ultimate number and say, okay, my data fitted to, let us say that to 2.8 or 1 after 20 iterations. Because again, this number are subject to how much uncertainty or error you are applying to the data to increase or decrease these values here. In my opinion, it is better to split this RMS and look at it from a different perspective. For example, if you look at the data at specifically at each site for each component for a period range, you will analyze the data in a better way. Again, this is an example, and the RMS at each site from this Newberry example data set, and the color are representing the RMS value at each site. Now here it is, because I didn't, or the data doesn't have the tipper, so it shows only the full impedance data. Of course, using your own tools or whatever tools, you can specify or look at the the RMS for specific component inside the full impedance tensor. And if you have tipper, you can also split between them and look carefully where you are fitting, where you are not fitting the data. Again, these RMS now, although we split them over the sides and component, but they are still for the full period range. You can specify, for example, depending on your tools and how you present this. But this is just an example on how to analyze or better analyzing your the data misfit obtained from the inversion. You can specify, for example, the period range, long period, short period, and where you are fitting the data better than the others. If we look at this example here, for example, the red points showing the high RMS values, for example, and these 3 points here. So you can go ahead, look at the sounding curve and analyze what is fitted, what is not fitted. And that is what I usually do. So I go from this overall RMS values from the look file, look at the RMS at each station, analyzing for each component, for each period range, and also look at the sounding curve and individually. And that is what I usually recommend you as a user to look at your sounding curve and compare the measured. In this example here, I'm showing the off-diagonal component from the full impedance tensor. Points are the measured data. The lines are the predicted data from the preferred model. And as you can see here, plotting the error bars at the top of this and start to analyzing side by side. I mean, even if they are fitted, I mean, depending on to which level of error you want to fit the data. It's also good to know where you are explaining and fitting the data. So looking, that is my recommendation at this point, is really to look at each sounding curve and analyzing individually in order to see what you are fitting, what you are not fitting, okay? So this is very important step, and I recommend all of you to look at that. Another practical remarks in order to control and monitor the inversion process, and I guess that many of you don't look at that, is the solver behavior. Okay, so it is not only about the inversion and how well and this overall RMS, but also the engine, the forward modeling engine, has an iterative solver. And if you remember, I mentioned that this solver, you can control it using the forward modeling parameter file. How many iterations you want to have the solver runs, to which tolerance you need this the iterative solver to converge. So very important step, in my opinion, is to look at the output screen. So this behavior of the solver is outputted on the screen, and it gives you some ideas about how well the solver is converging to the given values you provided. So usually you provide for the tolerance. I mean, for the QMR, I usually use 10 to minus 8 or 10 to minus 7 for the divergence correction in the version that you have. And also for the solver is like 10 to minus 8, 10 to minus 7. Now, this information are outputted on the screen, and it tells you, for example, at this period here, I mean, this here node number representing the specific period or period and polarization, it tells you how many iterations the QMR solver, the quasi-minimum residual solver, used to solve the partial differential equation is converged to the tolerance that you provided in the forward modeling control file, and how many minutes it takes. What I want to say here is, assume that you have provided like 700 iterations, okay, in the forward modeling control file, and a tolerance of 10 to minus 7, okay, and you see that the solver consumed all iterations, the 700 or 800 iterations, and the tolerance is still high, then you need to stop and think carefully about what is the solver is doing. Keep in mind, the solver is the engine. If something coming out from the solver, something wrong coming out of the solver, then you may expect that the whole process may fall. Okay. So you are solving the partial differential, or the solver is solving this partial differential equation in a wrong way. So you are not getting the correct electric field solution. So you need to stop and think about it. And some of the common reason why such kind of behavior that the solver doesn't converge is, for example, discretization, or the sites are located, the discretization is the main reason, or the some unexpected contrast in the model parameter and such kind of things. So you need to think about that and consider using that in a different way, or grading the model in a different way. Last but not least, I mean, today call message, you will be surprised that I will not directly relate these take home messages to on how to use the code. Because at the end of the day, I mean, you will get the user manual. You may get an access to, or you will get access to this this presentation or other materials on how to run the code from technical point of view. Yeah, how to pass some information to ModEM or other code. I mean, it is not related to only ModEM, this take-home message. They are a general comments related to the inversion in general. Keep in mind, the only input that you have is your data. So you go to the field, you collect the data, you process, and you want to run some inversion on this 1D, 2D, 3D, whatever code you want. Keep in mind that these are the main quantities that you have. The rest are built at the top of this. Okay, the model that you will use, the discretization, the error, and everything are related to that point. So my recommendation and take home message at this point is to understand analyzing the data to later better understanding the inversion result that you are getting. So when you look at the model, don't be surprised or disappointed that you are not getting this, you are not getting that, because the inversion is not magic, will not give you something which is not in your data. Okay. Believe me, even if I provide you with some ready-to-use recipe, there is nothing, something like this called that. And I get some requests or some emails saying, yeah, how to do this, how to do that with on my data set. It is a hard question. It is not easy to tell. I give you some guidelines on how to do this, how to do that. But at the end, each data set, that is at least in my experience, it has its own characteristic. And you need to handle this data set with some attention. You might adjust this, you might adjust the other parameters in order to get to a reasonable 3D conductivity model. Okay, so this is really a very important one. Even if I tell you the secret recipe or the magic recipe, it might not work on your data. Okay, so believe me, I mean, that's when I work with the several data set, this is my experience. Each data set, I consider it in a different point of view. And really, I mean, any, not ModEM, any inversion code is not magic. So if you provide noisy and or physically meaningless data, don't be surprised if you get meaningless models. So the inversion will not correct and remove noise from your data and or doing some magic in order to get a good model. I mean, I've listed this point here because I have a lot of discussion and emails, communication with people saying, yeah, okay, my data are, or why the inversion is not providing this and that. And when they send me a sample of their data, I mean, it is noisy, or there is no physical meaning of of these data. And okay, you don't expect ModEM or other code to correct such kind of information. To summarize, I mean, now related to ModEM is, ModEM is a modular system as explained in the first few slides for regularized inversion in frequency domain of EM data. So the idea is to support multiple inversion algorithm again. As academic user, you have the source, you can take a look and change, come up with some ideas for the inversion and or for the forward modeling and adapt it inside the whole system. And yeah, the modularity is emphasized here that you can change the model parameterization, regularization, adding new data type, as I explained before, that we have, for example, the most used one, impedance tipper, but we extended that phase tensor, interstation transfer function, ZTEM, or whatever. So you can add easily, that is the message here, and based on the modularity principle, you can easily add a new data type. Keep in mind, you will get the electric field solution from the lower level in frequency domain, and you can do whatever you want with that. You can get the magnetic field combined. I mean, there are a few combinations between the electric and magnetic field, and then you can get a new data type. Yeah, a stable version with basic capability is freely available for non-commercial use. And right now we have over 400 registered users of ModEM around the globe. And I really appreciate if you want to use the code, register or tell us how to or who are you, what you are doing with the code in order to add you on the list. And if there are some updates from ModEM, then you will get it. And also for our references to know who is using the code and add you as a user. And there are several publications using ModEM from real world empty data set, from tectonic continental scale to mineral exploration scale. So ModEM works with the various scales. And unfortunately, I don't have enough time maybe to show you some examples from around the world where ModEM is applied and the conductivity model obtained from that. And finally, we are really proud to see that ModEM is one of the most used code in the academic world, and it has a good reputation thanks to all of the users who are producing and developers who are producing good results and contributing more and more to ModEM. Yeah, with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I will leave you with this example that I have worked with a long time ago from Australia, the Cloncurry mining area. And here is an example showing the conductivity model presented here as ISO service for a conductive anomaly and some fault surface obtained from geological model. And it shows how the conductivity model correlates very well with some geological information from this study area. Thank you very much again. And sorry if I took maybe longer than I was expecting or less. I didn't monitor the time, to be honest with you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much, NASA. I mean, yeah, there was a lot to go through, and I hope everybody found it useful and worth sort of that extra bit of time. Maybe before we there already have been sort of quite a few questions in the Q&A, maybe before we get to that, sort of relating to your take home messages, yes, as somebody who does a lot of empty inversion and develops a code that has nothing to do with ModEM, I would say I exactly sort of agree with all the things you said there. I think these are absolutely right. My maybe sort of, well, first of all, my comment usually to PhD students when they are sort of disappointed about not being a magic recipe, I think it's a good thing because it keeps our jobs. Otherwise, yes, we would just press a button, apply the recipe, and
exactly
get the result. And the other thing, maybe as a sort of advice to new users, sort of do 20, 30, 40 inversions, try to learn from them, then throw them away, yes, and sort of start from the beginning again, because by that time you get a feel or an idea for what is going on. And I think that is extremely important, like the nothing replaces experience and all the things you raised.
Right.
Exactly what I would, you know, say to people.
Yeah, I mean, exactly what you are saying, Max. I mean, it is at the end, it is trial and error experiment. Of course, I mean, with more experience, with more runs, you will earn more experience in order to find out, okay, this data set requires this and that, and you will go faster in optimizing your inversion setting. But it's really, as you said, it is all of these comments and take-home message are independent from the code. So you need to do that in whatever code you will use.
Yes. Okay, so let's get to the question. So we have Abdul Aziz. Can we model out of quadrant and T-phase responses using ModEM and compare to this in 3DMT, so Veritas code, he thinks the model features are usually a bit weaker, the conductors. So two sort of related questions there.
Okay. So my answer on that, I mean, yeah, I mean, we don't specifically specify anything in ModEM to fit out of a quadrant. But in my experience, I mean, how you discretize is a major factor in order to fit this out of quadrant data. Now, related to your experience that ModEM produce weaker conductivity features, sometimes missing, when you compare it with Virchow 3D code. I mean, keep in mind, I mean, Virchow code solved the Gauss-Newton, which is a quadratic, and here we are talking about NLCG, non-quadratic inversion algorithm. So in other words, you may get good or enhanced conductivity contrast in few iterations with Virchow code, okay. But it depends on NLCG, I mean, it depends in ModEM how you are setting up the inversion. When you are changing, for example, the damping parameter. And all of this may influence the conductivity contrast in your model. And again, in my experience, I mean, assigning one uncertainty for the data and assume that everything should fit to that one might not be a good idea. So my recommendation to you is to look really at your data and see exactly what you are fitting and what you are explaining. Okay, so I mean, I more or less got the same comment from other users. And again, I mean, it depends on, some people assign only 15 iteration to NLCG. Of course, you will not get anything. Okay. Or of course, you will get something, but the contrast is not reached to get a good fit of your data. Okay. And how to assign the error is really a very good approach. So I hope that it answers the question.
Yes, I think that is also my experience. Okay, Joanna Ribeiro, thanking you for a great and clarifying presentation and a question probably many people have. The software to visualize all the things you showed, is that available for academic users?
Yeah, this is the software or the user interface called 3D Grid. It is in-house developed software. And to some extent, we give it to academic user in order to prepare their data, to model, to create models, and to visualize all. I mean, all of the figures here are prepared by these tools. Of course, we can give it to academia with some kind of restriction, but it's fine. We can give it to academia. It is called 3D Grid.
Okay, and just to clarify, I guess it's sort of sending an email to you to sort of inquire about how to get that, or?
Yeah, simply send me an email. I mean, we are small community, you know, and we communicate via emails and request via emails. And definitely, I mean, if someone writes me an email, we will communicate on that. And to provide this academic version of 3D Grid.
Yes. Okay. Then there are a few questions from Sayed Mohammed Furushani, who is always a sort of very active participant in this EMinar. However, in the interest of time, I think let me see if I can find the sort of one sort of particular. Okay, maybe the question. Oh no, that's not from him. So scalar impedance data. I suppose that's RM. Okay, let's talk about that. So RMT, I suppose, is scalar impedance, where that would come from. So can ModEM deal with that? Yeah.
Yes, I mean, the answer for that question, yes, you can. But if you have one, I mean, one scalar value in one direction, then the inversion will be biased along that direction. So it, if you have RMT in both from two different transmitters, if we are talking about RMT, then it will be much better. Of course, I mean, you can invert the phase, the apparent resistivity and phases. Now, to adapt, I guess the second part of the question was that if ModEM adjusts the grid during the inversion, no, it is not an adaptive gridding procedure. So whatever you start the gridding with, it will remain the same. So this is why I recommend all of the users to pay attention when they are gridding their model, specifically in the vertical direction.
Yes, and okay, then Romain Corseri, is there a way to impose hard bounds on the resistivity values? For example, set minimum value to 0.3 ohm meters and maximum to 10,000 ohm meters.
No, I mean, right now we don't impose that restriction, but it is one of the things that we really need to put. Nonetheless, I mean, I guess Kariki, who early day also modified a few things in ModEM, including, as far as I still remember, he included that kind of restriction. I mean, to impose, to force the inversion to be within specific bounds.
Okay, then there are a few people thanking you for your talk, and then Beijun Zhao, how to set the errors in the input files, I think specifically about error flaws. So I think I understand the question, do you need to deal with the error flaws outside of the ModEM sort of input file?
Yes, of course. I mean, that was one of the messages that I want to, I mean, to say also, whatever you provide, the ModEM will work with that. I mean, there is no adjustment for any values inside your data file. So now, related to your question on the error flaws and the errors, okay? So of course, if you trust the errors coming from your processing, which are based on the statistic, you need to apply some error flaws. But seriously, I mean, I got few data sets. When you look at the sounding curve, they have a lot of information, okay? They look reasonable, at least from my perspective, but the errors coming from the processing, they are really very large. Now, if you consider these errors in the inversion, you will not fit the data, these data. You will fit them, I mean, they will be somewhere inside this large error bounds, but they don't get to the measured data to explain them. So what I usually do, if I see some kind of large values of the errors coming from the processing, I simply ignore them. I don't apply these errors. I usually use like a standard or a constant value based on the noise level in the data. So how to obtain that? Looking at the data and get a better overview, how good or noisy your data or not. And then based on that, you can apply some error on that, okay, a constant error. But of course, if you trust the error coming from the processing, go ahead and apply some error flaws. And as I explained in one of these slides, is what I do usually, I use like a gradual decreasing of the error based on the idea that in the first runs, by applying relative large error, you are getting the regional information from the data. And now later, by decreasing this error, you are getting more and more local information from the data. And that way you can fit the data in a gradual way. Yes. I hope that is also explained or this answer you this question.
Yeah, and again, I would say this is something, it's an inversion thing. Yes, that persists in all codes. Although I'm a bit surprised to hear that you say that sometimes you decrease the error, because usually I see sort of poor data with small errors. I don't think I've seen many sort of good data with large errors.
Exactly. Data. Definitely. I mean, you can find all kind of error and data. That's definitely. But really, the main point here is to look at the sounding curve. Look, I mean, in case that I find a noisy point with the small error, I mean, looking at the curve as person working with MT, you should get an idea if that makes sense or not. See these specific points. If they don't make sense, simply ignore them, mask them. And keep in mind that ModEM works with any kind of combination. If you mask one specific point from one component, then the inversion should work. So analyzing pre-processing the data, in my opinion, is really an essential step prior doing any kind of inversion. And that takes me to this take-home message. If you provide noisy point, don't expect to get something reasonable of the data. And as you are saying, Max, I mean, if this noisy point has really small error values, you are forcing the inversion to fit some noise. I mean, that doesn't make sense.
Yes, exactly. Okay, so one question from just a Nick Dilfanai, converting EDIs to ModEM format.
Yeah.
What options are there?
Yeah, there are many options, including, as you said, I mean, maybe there is a script inside the source or the files that we are sharing. Nonetheless, there are several open source. MTPy, for example, it takes your EDI files, convert them to ModEM. We have our own tools, 3D Grid, that takes the EDI files and put them in ModEM format. And I guess there are other few open source or MATLAB codes to do that. So there are few available tools out there.
Yeah, and then I think we'll close with the final question from Marcus Burg. So what about DC sounding? I remember there was a joint inversion module option in one of your first slides.
Exactly. We do have, 3D inversion. And that was, in one of our publication, I have used Klaus Spitzer 3D finite difference code to prove the concept that by adopting additional module like DC geoelectric, plugging it to the system, everything should work. And I have proved that and use it in the joint inversion paper that I have published a few years ago. So yes, there is a DC geoelectric module, which is, it's completely standalone module. That means all the formulation taken from Klaus Spitzer finite difference code are backed in one module, and I only ensure this interface between this standalone module. It has its own solver also, everything, including that module. I only ensure that the interface to the inversion and parallelization is ensured, and it is working. So I have also shown that in that paper. Marcus, if you are interested, I will send you that paper.
Right. So yeah, we're reaching the 2-hour mark. So thank you very much, Naser, for that. I think, as I said, it was very informative, and I think many people appreciated.
Thank you very much
for that input. Don't forget, there is Malcolm Sandbridge next. So that's going to be interesting, more on inversion from a probably much more general point of view. So I hope to see most of you, all of you, again next week.
Thank you very much, Max. Thank you, everybody, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.